Good morning. Today we'll talk about subjective probability. If you think about most of events that happen, they are their probabilities are difficult to estimate. You don't have enough data to calculate relative frequencies. Here are some examples. Let's say you want to go for a picnic tomorrow and you wonder if it will rain, okay? Of course you can listen to, see the weather report, but that doesn't give you a precise probability. Typically you will see that the probability of rain is say 30%. But that is an estimate. Nobody has used previous data to calculate relative frequencies. Why? Because every day is different. So you don't have a lot of realizations of a repeated experiment to calculate relative frequencies. So you got to use judgment. Another question is, how about an earthquake of a severe earthquake in between 7.5 to 8 Richter scale in Southern California in the next 30 years? What is the probability that we will have such a severe earthquake? You cannot rely on data because very few earthquakes of this size, if any, have ever occurred. Also, you don't have many 30-year intervals. You don't have records in order to estimate relative frequencies. Okay? Other questions. Is the greenhouse effect real? Or global warming? Many people talk about this. There are a lot of heated discussions. But how do you determine if it is real? This is a one-time event. You don't have relative frequencies to estimate this event. Yet it's very important to answer this kind of questions. What is the probability that these undesirable effects can happen? Another question is, what is the risk that a particular insecticide causes cancer? Although we have some test results, we don't have enough cases to calculate relative frequencies. So by the time we determine the relative frequencies, it might be too late and a lot of people may have experience severe health problems. You are taking this class on decision analysis. What is the probability that you will get an A in this class, okay? Well, you may see previous records, but these records are for different students. You are one particular student. Even if you have if you see your transcript and review the records, every class is different, every professor grades differently. So how do you answer this particular question? What is the probability that you would get an A in this class? There are no relative frequencies. You cannot estimate the relative frequency from that, okay? Because you are a specific person, this is one type of class, so you don't really have data. Okay, so let's see how we address this kind of important issues. We'll consider two types of uncertainty. When you make important decisions, you face two types of uncertainty. The first one is what we call random uncertainty. Random. or some people call it risk. If you have random uncertainty, you can estimate relative frequencies. Okay, how? Well, you have data. One question, for example, when you deal with random uncertainty is, what is the probability that if you roll a die, you will get a 6, okay? If the die is fair, you can predict directly that without any calculations that the chance is 1/6, or the probability is 1/6. Or if you suspect that the die is not symmetric, or is weighted, then you flip it, you roll it many, many times, and then you collect data and you estimate the probability of getting 1/6. So one type of uncertainty is uncertainty in which you know or you can estimate probabilities very accurately, because you are dealing with events that occur very frequently, or you can experiment and get a lot of realizations. So this is the first time, random uncertainty or risk. And an example is, you roll a die. The die is supposed to be fair. What will be the outcome? Okay? If the die is fair, the probability to get any number from 1 to 6 is 1/6. Okay? Now, there is another type of uncertainty for which it's difficult, or it's not obvious, how to estimate probabilities. This is called epistemic uncertainty. And this is because of lack of knowledge. The word epistemic comes from the word episteme in Greek, which means I know. So this type of uncertainty doesn't have to do with relative frequencies, because you cannot repeat an experiment. It has to do with lack of knowledge. Most of the uncertainties are epistemic. Here, all these examples, what is the probability that you'll have an earthquake in the next 30 years that is very severe? Or if you think about the example that we did in the beginning of the class with the negotiation between two companies, Texaco and Pennzoil. Let's say there is an offer from Pennzoil to settle for 5 billion. What is the probability that Texaco will agree? Well, this is not an event that has happened many times. You cannot make experiments to, repeated experiments to find that probability. Even if you look at records of previous negotiations, every situation is different. So you cannot estimate probabilities. It's very difficult to estimate probabilities. And most real life problems involve uncertainty for which we cannot estimate probability. Okay? Now, based on this, we understand that there are two types of probabilities. One is relative, long-term relative frequencies, like flipping a coin, a fair coin, many times. Then you have a relative frequency. But you have also subjective probability. What is subjective probability? Subjective probability is actually, as the word implies, depends on the person. Every person has its own probability, estimates its own probability that some event will occur. Okay? And this is based on analysis of the situation and sometimes limited data if data is available. So, probability is divided into two types. Probability. One is the long-term relative frequency. The other is, the other type is subjective. Subjective probability. Okay? This is the degree of belief of an individual that a particular outcome will materialize. Degree of belief. That a particular outcome will materialize. Okay. So it is necessary in most situations to think about the situation and then assess probabilities of different events. And as we said, one example is a negotiation. Okay? If you go to a store, say they are selling computers, you see that the price is $1,000. You cannot afford that computer, and you think about, what if I offer $800? What will be the response? That is a subjective probability because you are dealing with one-time events, events that happen only once, so you cannot repeat them to estimate probabilities. Exactly. Now, degree of belief sounds kind of vague. Some people say, well, subjective is a term that is fuzzy. How can I, this is not precise. Every person has its own probability, but even the definition is not very clear. This term degree of belief doesn't sound very precise. Well, we are going to see that there is a precise definition of subjective probability. And this depends, is based on the willingness of someone to bet on a particular situation, okay? So if you are negotiating with another party, then if you believe that an outcome is very likely to occur, then you will be willing to place a higher bet, to bet more about on that particular outcome. Okay? If you observe someone, for example, who is willing to take a particular risk, let's say someone buys a stock, then it means that the belief of that person that the stock will go up, it's pretty high. Otherwise, the person wouldn't buy the stock, okay? So you observe how someone makes decisions, and then from that you infer the probability of that event. So there is a premise here that will make we can always assess a decision makers probability by observing how that individual makes decisions, okay? So let's talk about a procedure that is a standard procedure to assess subjective probabilities. Assessing assume that a person is risk neutral. Assume a risk neutral person. Okay? What does it mean, neutral person? Risk neutral person means that if you consider money, the value of that amount is proportional to the amount of money. Okay. So here we have a curve that shows the amount of money on the horizontal axis and the value of that amount of money, which we'll call utility, as a function of the amount. Okay? So here we put on the vertical axis utility. This is a number that varies from 0 to 1 and shows the degree of satisfaction with a certain amount of money. Okay. Most people, their curve that represents the utility as a function of the amount looks like this. Okay. What does it mean? Well, if you are in the beginning, if you talk about small amounts, typically the utility is proportional to the amount of money. So if someone has $100 and gets another 100, then the utility is double. However, as we go to very large amounts, we get to a point where there is saturation for most people. Okay. For example, if you have 1 million and someone gives you another $1 million, then it doesn't mean that the value is double it. Okay, because most people will be very satisfied with $1 million, so getting a second, another $1 million doesn't add much value for most of us, okay? So this kind of behavior, this kind of attitude is, shows a person who is risk averse. That means the person will not be willing to take risks in order to make more money. Say, the person has made $1 million in the stock market. Now, the person will not be very willing to risk, to take risks to double this amount of money, because having $1 million probably is good enough. So why risk to lose it in order to make more money? There are some people who are actually risk-seeking. Actually, they like to make risk, to take risks, because they are so greedy. Okay, so this is the utility curve as a function of the amount for a person who is risk-seeking, or risk, what we call risk perverse. Risk perverse. Okay. And then there is a line that is actually a straight line that shows the case where the amount, the utility is proportional to the amount of money. Okay? So this represents the utility of a person who is risk neutral. That means the value that is associated to an amount is proportional to that amount. You double that amount, you double the value. Okay. Now, we are going to consider risk neutral people to develop the rest of the theory of subjective probability. So let's write an important principle. This principle will explain clearly what subjective probability is and the method to assess it, estimate it. So principle wants subjective probability of an outcome of an uncertain experiment. Let's call the outcome A is, let's say that it is equal to a value P. Suppose that this is, as an example, 80% or 0.8. Okay? Then that person is indifferent between the following lotteries or gambles. Okay? So one is indifferent about the following lotteries or gambles. The first one is actually the sure thing. You just get 80 cents. 80 cents, $0.8. And You get that with probability 1. So this is certain. Okay, the other example or lottery that is equivalent to this fixed amount is a lottery that pays $1 with 80% probability and 0 with the rest of the probability, 0.2. Okay. Let's say that this is event A. If event A occurs, then the person gets $1. And then if it doesn't occur, then this is symbolized by A bar, gets nothing. Now, if the person is indifferent between these two lotteries, then the probability of A is equal to this 0.8, okay? Or equal to this amount, okay? So, if one person's subjective probability of event A is in some value, then that person is willing, to pay an amount equal to the subjective probability for a ticket of a lottery that is worth $1 if the event A occurs, and 0 otherwise. Okay. So, if one person's probability of an event A is equal to P, then that person is willing to bet, put her money where her mouth, wherever her mouth is, so is willing actually to bet $1 that this event will occur, okay? The higher the amount, the higher the probability. If that person thinks that the event is 99% certain to occur, then would be willing to bet a lot of money, to pay the ticket for a high price. If the probability is very small, say 1%, then that person will not be willing to pay much for the ticket. The maximum that would be willing to pay is 1 cent, because it's unlikely to win, okay? So the other statement is that the person also if thinks that an event is very likely to occur, will sell a ticket. If that wins, if the $1, if the event occurs, would ask for a lot of money, okay? If you have a stock that you are quite sure that it will go up a lot, and someone asks you to sell it, you would ask for a lot of money in order to sell it because you believe that it has a lot of value, okay? So one is willing to sell a ticket that is worth $1, if A occurs, and zero otherwise. For a price equal to the probability. Okay. So this is very logical. If something is highly likely to pay a certain amount, you want more money in order to sell that, okay? So this is a procedure that you can use to estimate the probability. So you could put on the table the ticket okay, so this is the ticket. This ticket is worth $1 if event A occurs. So you put this on the table, and also you put an amount on the table. So this is some amount of money, okay? Let's say this amount is 50 cents. And then you ask the person, the ticket or the certain amount, which one you prefer? If the person thinks that A is very likely to occur, then will not take this amount. Okay? All right, then you say, okay, let's increase that amount. Let's make it 0.7. Okay? So, the ticket or the amount, which one do you prefer? Well, if the person says, well, I still want the ticket, that means the person thinks that event A is very likely to occur. So, okay, you increase the amount, you make it 0.8, and then you say, the ticket or the amount, the fixed amount of 80 cents. Well, if the person says, well, the two are the same to me, I'll take any of the two. Okay, then that means that the person's probability for that event is 80% or 0.8. So the person's probability of A is 0.8. Okay. Now, you got to be very careful when you do this type of experiments to verify that the amounts are correct. So you could change the approach, this kind of elicitation approach, and start considering selling this ticket, okay? That means you ask the person, for what price would you sell that ticket, okay? When we say sell the ticket, means when you sell a ticket and you assume the responsibility to pay $1 if the event occurs, okay? So if the person, you start with a, say, a very high amount, okay? So here is the ticket, okay? And here is the amount. So you start with a high amount, say 90 cents. But this is high amount relative to one, okay? And then again, you say, well, the ticket or the amount of 90 cents, okay? So, or in other words, would you sell this ticket for 90 cents? If the person, oh sure, I would do that, it means that the probability that this event will occur is quite high. I'm sorry, it is lower than 90 cents or equal to 90 cents. So you reduce that amount, you say, well, if you don't, if you are selling it for 90 cents, would you sell it for 85 cents? The person may protest about that, but you say, well, this solicitation only, we're not really taking money. Then if the person says, oh yeah, I would still sell it, it means that the probability is smaller. The amount is, has a certain amount of 85 cents has more value than the ticket, okay? So then you reduce the amount, and if you go to 80%, then if this process has been done correctly, then the person will say that, yeah, okay, I think in this case that the ticket and the amount are the same, so I would sell the ticket for 80 cents, but I wouldn't sell it for a lower amount, okay? So this is a process that you can use to assess probabilities, subjective probabilities, okay? So there are actually three ways to assess subjective probabilities. Three ways to assess subjective probability. The first one is you could try to ask directly the decision maker about this probability. So directly ask decision maker what his or her probability is. Okay. Now this is not highly recommended because most people cannot answer directly such a question because they have, most people think about long-term relative frequencies. They don't talk, they don't think about this kind of gambles, okay? So this is not a recommended approach. The other way is to have this process that you find out what kind of gambles the person is willing to place. So ask about what bets the person is willing to place. Okay. And the third one is to compare a lottery that involves the outcome whose probability you want to estimate with another lottery whose probability is specified. Okay? This could be, for example, rolling a die. Or if you have a wheel of fortune, rotating it and then see where the needle stops. So compare a lottery involving the outcome whose probability you want to assess, whose probability you want to assess with a reference lottery whose probability mechanism is specified. Whose probability mechanism is specified. Let's see an example where we assess probabilities. So, example. Let's say that the outcome is about a game. So you have, let's say, Los Angeles Lakers and the event is that you are trying to estimate the probability that they will win against the Detroit Pistons. Okay, say in the NBA Finals. Okay, of course you can look at data from previous years, but every year things change. So the performance of the strength of different teams changes. So it's not very clear how to do that. Okay, so this is the event A, that Los Angeles Lakers will win. So you are looking for this probability. Okay, so you consider two alternative bets. On one bet, you bet for Lakers that they will win. In the other, you bet against the Lakers. Okay? So here we have a decision node. Here you bet for Lakers. Bet for Lakers. And the other option is to bet against the Lakers. Bet against Lakers. Okay. So this is an uncertain event. So we show with a circle that this is an uncertain event, if you bet with the Lakers. And then here are the two outcomes. If the Lakers win, then you get X, you win X amount of money. If they lose, well, you bet that they will win, so you lose some money in this case. So Lakers lose, then you lose some money, this amount. Okay? And here is the second lottery where you have bet against the Lakers. Okay. So let's say that if the Lakers win, then you lose because you bet against them. And in that case, you lose minus X amount. And then if the Lakers win, if they win, you bet against them, so you lose X. If the Lakers lose, then because you predicted it, you gain Y. Okay? And these two amounts, X and the X here are equal, and the Y here are equal. Okay. Now, you try to find out for what amounts X and Y, the two bets are equivalent. That means the decision maker thinks that both bets are equivalent. It would take any of the two bets, okay? So we found the amounts X and Y for which the two bets are equivalent. Find amounts for which the two bets are equivalent. Before we estimate the probabilities as a function of X and Y, let's see what will happen if you think that the probability that Lakers will win is very high. So let's say that the probability of A is very high. It's very high, there's a very high probability that Lakers will win. Say 95%. Okay? Then what will happen with the amounts? Well, then the amount that you would be willing to, that makes the two bets equivalent, this amount would be much smaller than the amount that you would lose. Okay? So X will be very, very low compared to Y. Okay? Why is that? If you are very, very certain that Lakers will win, then you are willing to take a big risk to lose a lot of money if they lose in order to make few a small amount. Okay? If I knew that they were very, I was very certain that they would win, then I would say, okay, I'm willing to bet that they will win, and I'll take $1 if they win, but if they lose, I'm willing to lose $10. Okay? All right, now let's see what happens. What is the probability in terms of these amounts? If you have determined these amounts by asking questions, find the probability of the event. Okay? So find the probability of A. If you know the two amounts X and Y, okay? If the two bets are equivalent, it means that the expected payoff of the two bets, the two expected payoffs are equal. Okay, so equivalent lotteries means the mean value if you bet for Lakers equals to the mean value if you bet against Lakers. Against Lakers. Okay? All right, so let's see, let's write the equations for the two mean values. If you bet for the Lakers, then you have a probability equal to P to win X dollars. But also there's the probability to lose, which is 1 minus P times Y. Okay. Now, if you bet against the Lakers, the payoff will be, or the average payoff will be minus P times X, because in that case you lose X if they win, plus 1 minus P times Y. And since the two bets are equivalent, that means you would trade one for the other, then the two, the left-hand side is equal to the right-hand side, okay? Then you can solve for this unknown probability, okay? If you solve for this unknown probability, here is the answer. The unknown probability is equal to the amount Y divided by X plus Y. That's the probability. Okay? So if the probability that you will think that they will win, Lakers will win, is high, if this probability is very high, say 99%, then X will be very small. Okay? So the numerator and the denominator will be almost equal, so the probability will be very close to 1. Okay? So if X is much, much smaller than Y, then P the probability is very close to 1. Okay? And the other way around, if you think that the probability that they will win is very small, then x, the amount that you would have to ask in order to take the risk to bet on the Lakers, would be very high relative to the amount that you were willing to lose. Okay? All right, so in this lecture, we have concluded two things. That in most real life situations, probabilities are not relative frequencies. There are no relative frequencies to estimate. And if you think about it, with the exception of things like playing in a casino or buying lottery tickets, most probabilities are actually subjective. There are no relative frequencies, so you have to think about that. And every person has its own beliefs and therefore probabilities. So going back to the negotiation between Pennzoil and Texaco, the probability that Texaco will accept a counteroffer of $5 billion is something subjective. There are no previous records of similar situations from which to estimate probabilities. So this is the first message, that most probabilities are subjective. They are not relative frequencies. Okay? And the second one is that there is a procedure that is based on logic from which you can estimate someone's probability of failure. Okay? I'm sorry, but probability in general. So if you have studied probability theory, especially subjective probability, you could assist the CEO, say, of Pennzoil in terms of estimating a favorable outcome of a negotiation or a favorable outcome of the court. Okay? Subjective probability is something that is a concept that is based on first principles. It's crisply defined. It's very clear what subjective probability is. It's the willingness to bet and the amount that you're willing to bet for an event. The higher the amount, the higher the probability. Okay? Now, assessing the probability using this procedure, it's kind of tricky. You have to be very careful to ask the right questions and make sure that you ask the question, you ask the questions in different ways in order to estimate correctly the probabilities.